This is one of my essays with them. It's called My Thoughts on Guns as a Mentally Ill Person. I have schizoaffective disorder, anxiety, and PTSD. Upon one of my many discharges from the psych ward, I had to sign an affidavit that I would not buy a gun for 5 years. I have no desire to buy, own, or even be fatally near a gun ever in my life. That is not happening. No gun ownership for me. As I watched mass shooting play out on CNN and Obama's, this is written a long time ago, that's why the mag's out of print, recent town hall on guns, the same themes play out over and over. The mentally ill are continually blamed for gun violence as a convenient scapegoat to avoid facing the real culprit for gun violence. Toxic masculinity and the sheer ease and availability of gun ownership in America. Over Christmas, before I lived here, I went to Reno, Nevada to visit my extended family. On a snowy day, my parents and I went to two massive sporting goods stores to search for binoculars and a thermal vest. Nevada really is the Wild West still. Hunting is big there. I have never seen so many weapons in one place in all of my life. Handguns, rifles, crossbows, bows and arrows. Everything one might need for the next mass shooting was neatly displayed and sold in Cabela's in Newtown. In Cabela's, I Instagrammed a gluttonous plethora of taxidermy dioramas. We toured the audio animatronic dead Republican presidents display in the upper lever of Shields by the Ferris wheel. Okay, Nevada's weird. It was an overstimulating circus. With my overwhelming, fearful revelation of how many people around me might be concealed carrying, now that I know how easy it was to buy a gun, I had to take a calming Xanax in the snack bar. Conspicuously California, in my ridiculous leggings. I felt like a target. Guns and rednecks terrify me. Most mentally ill people never commit a violent act. Only about 4% of violence in the United States can be attributed to people diagnosed with mental illness. Yet we, my people, are continually blamed for violent acts. My mother said to me when I told her I was writing this essay that she felt one must be insane in order to commit a violent act. That is an erroneous definition of insanity, but one which the public conveniently conflates upon the gun control debate. In all of my reading of the DSM, 4 or 5, whatever up to now, I read 4, I know no mental health diagnosis that produces violent behavior with the exception of possibly paranoid schizophrenia and PTSD. Even those two antisocial personality disorder. But even those two stereotypes of the paranoid schizophrenic political activist or crazy vet can be dispelled by examining the racist and politically motivated causes for those stereotypes and why they would blame someone for violence. I can attest, most schizophrenics with PTSD would really prefer to be left alone than have to contend with any sort of violence whatsoever. We hate that shit. In the case of PTSD, violence is often what began our troubles in the first place. Anxious, bipolar, depressed, OCD, PTSD-afflicted citizens are far more likely to take their own lives than that of other people in order to escape the misery of being mentally ill, believe me, I know. Mentally ill people have more to fear from guns at their own hands than other people do from them. Suicide is the biggest reason why the mentally ill shouldn't have guns, if you ask me. I don't think the mentally ill should be allowed to own guns to protect us from ourselves because of our suicide risk. I don't know. Just now, every moment. No one except law enforcement should have guns, according to me, who no one listens to. Even police have proven to be woefully inadequate in keeping their mental health response teams from just shooting the suicidal person in crisis. Police routinely shoot, as you know, unarmed African-American children in playgrounds and citizens at traffic stops, just for being in public. In the UK, however, even the police don't have guns, and they have very little gun violence whatsoever. They have like a stabbing epidemic, which seems adorable, but that is something for the US to consider, although I doubt it would ever happen. A study I read online said that an extensive survey of police incidents reports demonstrate that far from posing threats to others, people diagnosed with schizophrenia have victimization rates 65% to 130% higher than the general population. Victimization is a greater public health concern than perpetration. Even schizophrenia, which as a schizoaffective is part of my diagnosis, yes, I'm open about it, and it's the most common target of the violent psychopath stigma. I'm sure you've heard people say psycho, that's really very pop psychology ableist, not okay. But schizophrenia is usually marked by social isolation, withdrawal, and introversion into a fantasy world. Yep. I would much rather be inside, peacefully hallucinating fairies and ghosts in the white walls of my home, and listen to the voices of my dead ancestors counseling me, then marauding about committing crimes. Violence is caused by interpersonal conflict, passion, poverty, racism, religious xenophobia, and political intent, not by mental illness. We, the mentally ill, if I may speak, at least me, one, are peaceful. I am hallucinating peacefully in my home in Reno most of the time. I wish only not to be harmed by these angry white male rednecks of Jesus carrying in Reno and everywhere else, occupying the bird sanctuary in Oregon as they did a few years ago when this was written. I think this was written in 2012, that magazine is old. But please, keep your nasty guns away from me, okay? I know if the revolution starts, this overthrowing the government, weird-ass revolution people speak of, I'm getting shot pretty early into it, so... Or I won't survive without my meds, so I have no such hopes for the revolution. The risk is exponentially greater that individuals diagnosed with serious mental illness will be assaulted by others, which has happened, rather than the other way around. Given how easily the mentally ill are gaslit, later violence is common. I have been the victim of domestic violence more times when the presence of a gun in the apartment would have resulted in my death. Strangulation and knife fights, I was able to survive. If there was a gun on that bedside table, I would have died. More women are killed at the hands of domestic partners than any other way. My boyfriend repeatedly tells me why you still have a boyfriend. No, I'm proud. Much better, let's be the answer. But okay, this boyfriend back in LA used to tell me he wanted to get a gun. He was not abusive, but quick-tempered and emotionally abusive in his own way, even though he didn't hit me. When I told him about my fears of getting shot by him on a hike in Griffith Park back when I lived in LA, he got so angry at me that I almost didn't have a boyfriend by the time I got off the mountain. After watching a marathon of American Horror Story Hotel at his house, I had a nightmare about sleeping on a mattress with a gun underneath it, feeling the cold whole death-dealing barrel through the mattress. When I awoke, I decided I was better off not knowing if there was a gun under the mattress, and I never looked for one. It was only a dream, I hope. Online, I read that the number of American troops killed in Afghanistan and Iraq between 2001 and 2012, when this must have been written, was 6,488. The number of American women who were murdered by current or ex-male partners during that time was 11,766. That's nearly double the amount of casualties during war. It is war to be a woman at home. I didn't think back then that my boyfriend would actually shoot me, but I cannot help feel the fear that comes of being female. I have many fears like that. All those times I was raped, a gun wouldn't have helped, wouldn't have saved me. Personally, I'd far rather be raped if I must than go to jail for shooting someone I was fighting with and possibly romantically linked to, because, you know, courts don't get it right. Given my ineptitude at shooting, I have never shot a gun, and shy nature, truly. Any attempts by me to use a gun in self-defense would likely result in me getting shot as well. I mean, that's usually what happens to these people that have guns in their houses for home invasions. They get shot. So, I would never shoot anyone, even if I did have a gun. I don't think I have the stomach for it. I don't even hit people. I mean, once I grew up and stopped beating up on my little sister, I yuck. And my preferred self-defense method is running away. Although I did used to carry pepper spray. A gun only works for self-defense if you know how to use it. And even then, it is far more likely to be turned against you. Guns frighten me. As a mentally ill person, I have no desire to own one, or even be in the same room as one, or house. I agree with the dominant discourse that mentally ill shouldn't have guns because of our suicide risk. But I don't think any of you sane people out there should be allowed to have them either. Clearly, with the rate that people are dying, the sane populace, just as much as the insane, can't be trusted with guns. I mean, what the fuck? It's not exactly generating trust that you all in Reno can manage your firearms given how many shootings there are all the time. I mean, toddlers shoot more people than terrorists. There's an epidemic of children getting a hold of their parents' guns and shooting each other, or adults, anyone. We have a dangerous crisis on our hands. I mean, I wrote this before the Trump crisis, of course, you can probably tell. Yeah, now I have other crises. The president, Obama, our old president, said that something must be done about the widespread gun violence, and the nation agreed. But we all disagree on what to be done actually is. I don't have a solution either, sorry about it. For the moment, it is all I can do sometimes not to just stay in my house and hide from the dangerous gun-toting Americans outside.